morning, dear participants and delegates, and welcome back to the second scientific session of Day 5 EFTP program sponsored by Atal AICT New Delhi and organized by Roland Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences, Odisha. Dear participants, for this session, we have our next eminent resource person, Dr. Mukesh Singh Sirkawar, sir, with us. First of all, I'd like to welcome Dr. Mukesh sir into this EFTP program platform and thank him for accepting our invitation. Welcome to you, sir.
Thank you.
Without further delay, let me take the opportunity to introduce Dr. Mukesh Singh Sirkawar sir to all of us ahead of his presentation. Dr. Mukesh Singh Sirkawar sir is currently working as associate professor in Faculty of Pharmacy, MIST University, Malaysia. Sir has served as organizing secretary for Falling Wall Labs in Malaysia, held in 2019, 2018, 2017 and 16, hosted by MIST University. Sir was invited in first stakeholder engagement workshop on the Malaysian Science Communication Module by Young Scientist Network ASM in the year 2019, organized by Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Sir was invited as keynote speaker and co-chair second Global Summit on Herbals and Natural Remedies in the year 2016, held at Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Sir was invited as plenary speaker at University of West Indies and participation was fully sponsored by the organizers. Dr. Sirkawar sir was selected as finalist of Falling Walls Young Innovator of the Year 2015 at Berlin, Germany, and the participation was fully sponsored by Falling Walls Foundation Germany and its partner. Sir was selected to present research in innovation challenge at Yayasan University, Malaysia. Sir has developed modules and designing templates for outcome-based education system in MIST University, Malaysia. Dr. Singh sir has received his PhD in pharmacy from KAD University, Belgaum, India in the year 2011. His current area of research is herbal antioxidants, anti-diabetics and anti-hyperlipidemics, novel drug delivery in herbal drugs, formulation and evaluation of herbal drugs and food safety. Sir has more than 14 years of experience in mentoring students in pharmacognosy and chemistry subject. Sir has supervised 11 undergraduate research projects with significant outcome on investigation of plant pharmacognostic profiles and its antioxidant activities. Dr. Singh sir has published 64 research and review papers in various peer-reviewed international and national journals and also serving as reviewer for many international journals. Sir has presented 29 research papers in various national and international conferences. Sir has attended many MOOC courses and online CME programs from online learning programmers. He is an editorial board member of the Open Hypertension Journal, Bentham Open, consulting editor, Botanics, Targets and Therapy, Doe Press, UK, editorial board member of Pharmacognosy Review Journals. He is a life member of APTI, member of SN Council of Science Editors and registered as pharmacist with the Madhya Pradesh State Pharmacy Council, India. With this brief introduction, it's me with great privilege, I would like to invite Dr. Mukesh Singh Sirkawar sir on board to deliver his talk.
Thank you, Dr. Rajaram Das.
Thank you, sir.
Is my presentation now visible? Thank you.
Make it full screen, sir.
Yeah. Is it visible now?
Yes, yes. Continue, sir. Yes. Thank you.
All right. So, good morning to all of you. I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me to give a talk on a very significant and relevant topic in current scenario. And I would like to appreciate the Roland Institute of Pharmacy and also the Atal program of AICT for bringing out such a relevant topic. So before I give a talk on today's topic, Let me tell you, this artificial intelligence subject was quite an alien subject for me when I studied, you know, in B.Pharm and M.Pharmacy and even PhD. So during that time, this artificial intelligence was not even, you know, taught in a pharmacy. And I'm sure that currently also, if it is part of an anti-integrative module, what we know about during that time was computer-aided drug design. And mostly one of the pharmaceutical engineering subject we used to study. So that was, I mean, a kind of exposure what we got about the engineering during that time. So I hope that this is a one step forward in this direction, where in the institute like Roland Institute of Pharmacy is organizing such a program to bring awareness and to, you know, bring such an important topic in the view of the students. And I know that most of the viewers today are the faculty members of the distinguished institutes, because it is a faculty development program. So I'm sure that most of you will agree that this topic is actually not integrated in the pharmacy syllabus or pharmacy subject, as is the need of the current scenario. So I truly appreciate that. And since I'm not from the domain of AI, and even I'm not from the domain of the computer-aided drug design, so I'll be mostly focusing my presentation on the mostly on the complementary and I mean the traditional and complementary system of medicine. So let me tell you that the views expressed here are my own, and they do not necessarily reflect the view of any employer. And also the information given here is for the education purpose only. So the flow of presentation will be what is an artificial intelligence and application of AI in various domain, and application of AI in healthcare, and application of AI in pharmacy. And then we'll discuss little about what is a traditional and complementary medicine, and then role of the traditional, complementary and alternative medicine having the role of AI. So what is an artificial intelligence? I think a lot has been spoken in the past few days, and most of the speakers have given the detail at length about the artificial intelligence and their subsets and the type of the artificial intelligence and how does it work, and what is a machine learning, what is a deep learning, what are the neural networks, what is a natural language processing and cognitive computing. So these are the various subdomains of artificial intelligence, and we know that intelligence is something which is very much important for human being, and such an intelligence is now you know, expected from the you know, from the robots or even from the, you know, computers. So that is something which is going to be very exciting to see in the future. So let us go to the applications of AI in various domain. So as I mentioned to you that in past few days, you must have learned a lot of applications part in different domains. So I'll just quickly go through a few of the applications here, and then we'll move to the main agenda. So AI in the different domains give us the, you know, the clue how the data, how the digital, you know, data is giving a lot of feed to the these computers or these AI based programs to give the recommendations based on the maybe historical data or even concurrent data. This AI is being developed, so accuracy of the AI, or you can say the any machine or AI based program, is based on the data feed. So how is the data, where the data is correct data or it is authentic data? So data cleaning processing is very, very important. And I think some of the speakers even told in you know, previous presentations that in pharmaceutical science or in pharmacy sector, there has been a problem with the data. So sometimes we cannot you know, reproduce the data in case of some articles, even publications. Even we don't have even the much data which can be you know, can be utilized to develop such a system in pharmacy. But gone are the days. Now is the time to move forward so AI can transform the data-driven industries. So the pharmacy has to become a data-driven industry. So we have to even include some of the courses on the data, because there is a lot of scope of nowadays on the data scientist or, you know, data processing and all that. So the industries which are data driven, they have a huge applications of these AIs. So some of the industries which are having the potential use of AIs are healthcare, e-commerce, human resource, even robotics. So apart from that, there are many other industries which actually now exploring the role of the AI or use of the AI, because now we are living in the digital era, and we are talking about digital economy and cryptocurrency. Then, you know, more data, more accuracy kind of a thing. So the revolution of last 10 to 12 years has happened because of the availability of the huge data. So even the telecom sector has actually grown substantially. Even the other sectors, even the you know, the computer sector has also grown substantially. So we need to go hand in hand with the other sectors so that we should not be, you know, lagging behind when it comes to the progress to a particular industry. Okay, so some of the applications which are quite common in using the artificial intelligence, what we are using nowadays, like Google Maps, many people knowingly or unknowingly, whether they know it or not, whether they are using the artificial intelligence in the daily life, but anyway, they are using it. And that's a problem nowadays, that the science communication, the science is there, but the general public, how to communicate that science to the public is a different area. So in some of the countries, even they are coming out with a lot of policies wherein the science should be communicated to the general public so that they should know. So the general public, even they are using a lot of gadgets which includes the artificial intelligence, and not aware about their benefits. Even they are not aware about what would be the, you know, challenges. So we know about Google Maps, we know about the, you know, the assistant, intelligent assistants in phones like Siri, Alexa, Cortana from the Microsoft, which can send you the reminders, the emails, you know, if any you know, projects are pending and all. And we have this plagiarism detectors like Turnitin, Grammarly. There are so many plagiarism detectors. And then this the cabs, the Ola, Grab, Uber, Lyft. And we have this Audible for the listening the books. So many books are nowadays published in versions, like digital version, wherein you can listen the whole book, no need to read even. So the book can be fully audible. And then biometric identification, like face recognition, or, you know, iris recognition, which is coming up in the computers, in phones. And even some of the institutes or in industry, they have put the biometric, you know, even for attendance and all. So these things all, I mean, if you see that they involve more or less the different subset of the artificial intelligence. So even nowadays, we have this recommendation engines in by the use of AI. So most of this e-commerce website, so if you make a purchase, that website, the AI-based engine will recognize your purchase, you know, the pattern. They will recognize your likes and dislikes and then recommend to you. Even in the Facebook also, you will get a lot of recommendation of your old friends if they are from your institute or, you know, from your area. And even in the Netflix, if you watch a particular movie, then they will start recommending you since you watch this movie, so you may like this also. And in YouTube also, if you listen a music, particular type of music, then the music recommendations will also, you know, so like that. You will see this recommendation engines are also coming up, and I think most of the e-commerce websites they are including, and you know, for the benefits. So this article, actually I got it today, I read today, it was very interesting, so I thought of sharing it. This is published today actually in one of the leading newspapers, Star News. And here in in Belgium, one of the digital artists has developed the AI tool that monitors how long the politician in the, you know, in the parliament session, they are spending time on the smartphones. So this is, I mean, kind of a different way of application of AIs. So AI, you will see, is being rolled out in many industry, in many places. We'll see, even, you see, in the education sector, in China, in 200 schools, they have actually employed around 200, schools have employed the Kiko robots. And these Kiko robots are, in the schools teaching children about the grammars or English. Likewise, you will find the robotic application in education sector in upcoming years. Now, the non-humanoid robots are already there. You will find even on Amazon, and you will find on even purchase sites like this Kiko. This is, people can buy, wherein they can teach children about these alphabets, you know, even the simple English words. So if you look at this robotic market in the education sector is coming up, whether we like it or not, it is coming up, especially this COVID-19 situation. This has put many industry in a situation wherein they have to look into the other alternatives. If you look at the industry like tourism industry, what we call hotel industry, transport industry, education industry, now they have to look out for the alternative sources wherein they can survive. So in the educational sector now, some of the universities are going fully online, and some are, you know, having the hybrid mode wherein some of the sessions will be online, some will be lab sessions will be face to face. So if you see that the kind of the platforms which are coming up in the education sector is quite overwhelming. You will see Edmodo, Edpuzzle, Kahoot, then Microsoft, WebEx, then Google Meet, Zoom. I mean, see, this area is growing like anything. And in the upcoming days, we will see a lot of changes in the education sector as well. We will see even the inclusion of the humanoid. Maybe we can see even the humanoid robots in upcoming days. So here is another, you can say, the example of a Hong Kong startup developed by the PopSent Robotics, wherein they use the voice interaction technology. And this is for teaching the children about the English language skills. So AI-based teachers, they can be a buddy, like buddy, who can help children or students with the self-paced learning. So the education system or education sector is coming up in a different way in the future because of this pandemic. And you will see even this robotics or robots, they have been, have a lot of demand in many other industries, including education industry. Now, you see this Mitri, which is India's first HR robot. And in the industries now, the HR jobs are taken up, or in future is going to be taken up by these robots because of the correct, there are so many advantages if you look at that, like correct HR data, reduce the labor cost, even working 24/7 by 365 days, no leave, right? So, I mean, this area is also utilizing the robots. And another one is a Mitra. This is also Indian-based or made in India robot. And this Mitra actually was utilized by some of the hospitals during this COVID-19, wherein they use these robots to walk into the patient wards and then interact with the patients. And they got like tablet on the chest, wherein the patient can interact with their loved ones. So, I mean, this is also quite interesting to see how the robots has been utilized in such a difficult situation. And I think coming to the humanoid kind of robots, in India, Kerala Engineer is working on a Chaya, which is the Indian version of Sophia. I think you know about Sophia. Some of you may be knowing about Sophia. So Sophia is actually the first humanoid robot which was developed in the Hong Kong-based company Hansen Robotics, and that got the citizenship as well. So in India also, there's a humanoid robot named Chaya is under development. So this is what I was talking about. Hansen Robotics, they launched Sophia in 2016. And you'll be surprised to know that the Sophia got the citizenship. Sophia is a Saudi Arabian citizen, and she got the UN first non-human innovation championship in November 2017. So the United Nations also, you know, recognized as Sophia as a citizen and given the award for the innovation champion in 2017. So this is something quite interesting to know how the AI is changing different fields. Look at this. This one is a Dutch restaurant, Netherlands, wherein the robots like Emmy, Ecker, James, they are actually, you know, serving foods in the restaurants and, you know, hanging out with the customers. So in the restaurants also, the AI has entered. And classification of common fruits using neural network. Again, here also the you know, the classification of the different type of apples, different type of mangoes, you know, different type of, you know, the food and vegetables with the quite accuracy of the data. And of course, this area also not left out. The defense is one of the most important area when it comes to India, because of the neighboring countries. So army also now have to learn about AI and robotics, because the neighbors, you see the neighbors also, they also display the land, sea and air combat robots at the expo. I think this is the news of last few days before 6 July. So this current situation is wherein you have to grow up in all the areas so that you survive. And this is another one where in the 50 new planets from the old NASA data has been utilized by AI or screened by AI to identify. The data was there, but such a huge data and need some technology. So the AI is now become very handy in such a scenario. Some of the companies in India, this is quite interesting, that one of the insurance company, they utilizing this AI to resolve this claims within 30 minutes. And the Bajaj insurance, I read in the news that they use this Digi Swastha. Digi Swastha is a kind of an app wherein before applying to the policy, they have to go through that app, and that app will actually very quickly will, you know, give the result. Whether to proceed with this application or not. Likewise, that they have a Profit, and that actually keep a eye on the current health status of the, you know, the insurer. And then the Motor OTS, they have this motor on the spot for accident claims. So wherein any accident happen, or immediately on spot, the person can feed up the images in the system, and then the claim can be processed on the spot. So such kind of interesting things are happening in the various sectors. Look at this. Digital assistant can even recommend the fashion types or clothes types based on the height, weight, even size. So the classification of these fashion images also become very popular in the AI sector. Now this is again a recent news wherein in Dutch artist, they actually could restore the original size of this portrait after 300 years. So this is again a marvelous use of the AI in this sector. Of course, the agriculture cannot be you know, untouched from the AI. So if you look at here, these robots are actually taking this vertical farming to a different level, wherein the farmer will have the information about the weather forecast, even any deficiencies in a particular soil, or even the robots can even be helpful in harvesting for these crops. So the precision agriculture is the future, and I mean, these possible diseases, specific fertilizers, and you know, even the drones can be used to keep vigil you know, in the fields is upcoming. So if you look at the applications in the healthcare sector is again a booming sector, because during this crisis, the most important thing the human realize is the health. Okay, so the healthcare sector also growing with leaps and bounds. So if you look at the applications of the AI in the healthcare sector, there are so many diagnostic the applications which are coming up. Even the integration of the diagnostic is the future, wherein the MRI, CT, and all will be integrated together, okay, under one umbrella, and diagnostic will be fast and too accurate. So like LSAN, a deep neural network of the AI that uses the two-pronged approach to scan the electronic health records and then identify the information and predict the patient is facing any, you know, deadly disease in the future, is quite interesting to know such kind of things are actually there. So if you look at this image, this is about the robots, robotic surgery. And India is actually is a health destination. India is a health destination for, you know, for many countries. So people from different country, they come to India just for the treatment, because the healthcare is comparatively, I say, is cheaper in India, and you got a sophisticated technology. You have got sophisticated machines, like robotic surgery is one of them. And most of the major hospitals like Apollo, Hinduja, Fortis, you know, in Medanta, Max, they all have this robotic surgery or robots for the surgery, and this is phenomenal. And recently, the artificial intelligence in the eye health, Shankar Netralay, you know, in Tamil Nadu, in Chennai. So Shankara Eye Foundation, they have actually collaborated with the Leban Care for coming out with the formula of AI Netra. And this particular technology can detect the, you know, the issues in eye within minutes. Like in a patient of a diabetes, it can detect the retinopathy in few minutes. So that can save a lot of time for the doctor. So this AI can be actually very handy in terms of assisting the doctors. So a patient who is diabetic and having a retinopathy, and if the AI can identify, the definitely the physician can make decisions on these surgeries, whether to go for it, and what should be the precautions, and all those things can be, you know, can be predicted with the help of AI. So deep learning, because many of the images are in this area, has been utilized for feeding as a data the AI. So this is again a growing sector, and in India it's already there. Okay, in one of the large non-profit multinational Shankar Netralay, very popular in other countries as well. So now if you look at the other the applications of AI in healthcare, there are so many actually. So nowadays it is called as Internet of Medical Things. You must have heard of IoT, Internet of Things. I think in past few days there is a thing called Internet of Medical Things, or Internet healthcare, Internet of Things. So these are actually the medical devices which are connected with the software applications, which can communicate and can give a lot of applications in the healthcare system. So there are some like smart medical diagnosis and remote patient management, the patient can be at home or remote area, can be monitored from the hospital. Even during this COVID-19, most of the people, they look for the application where they can take the appointment with the doctor online and can feed the, you know, the reports, diagnostic reports and everything in the application. And before, you know, the interaction with the doctor can see your all the reports and can, you know, prescribe. So this is a different way of, you know, going in the current situation. As I told you, this desperate time needs a desperate measure. So this put a lot of industry in such a way where they have to go, you know, they have to use online services, they have to go for alternatives. So real-time bio-tracking, automatic disinfections in hospitals, even in pharmacies, and cardiac monitoring, like people who have like arrhythmia and all, they can be monitored. And then mobile app connected with the wearable devices, like continuous BP monitoring and all, and telehealth, and pills with the microscopic sensors connected with the wearable devices in certain patients who, you know, wherein the drug adherence is a big problem, like Alzheimer and all. So there also it's quite interesting. This is again in healthcare. This is a breakthrough wherein you can see the 3D printed organs already in progress, and a lot of doctors are working on it. And then you will see a lot of prosthetics are already been, you know, distributed in India, in Kerala, and many other, you know, states. Wherein this the printed 3D printed organs are already in research, and even this many other human organs are already in research or in the 3D printing. So this is another way wherein they have used this behavioral health. The data has been used to go into the behavioral health, and also the role of AI in the behavioral health. Now, this is again from India, and this is what I call the social impact or the purpose of the science. What we learn in the higher education, what is the purpose of the higher education? Higher education is to teach the individual to go into the research and come out with the ideas, come out with the, you know, the various researches, and translate those research so that it could, you know, help the mankind, help the society, and should have a social impact. So here also, as you can see, this gentleman is actually created a wearable virtual assistant, and that helped the you know, the blind people to read. So this particular device can be, you know, wear in hand, and then simply points to the point the finger towards the printed text, and then device will read out what is written over there. And this is it's a kind of boon to the blind people. Now this is another one wherein the team of scientists at the NTU in Singapore, they have developed the millimeter size robots, and this is the future. Wherein these nano magnets, they can be, you know, introduced, and they can pave the way for the future application in biomedicine. And then next is coming to the application in pharmacy. Now what I listened in past few days, we mainly discuss about the computer aided drug design, drug discovery. So is it that only, what do you say, the application in pharmacy? Is it the only application in pharmacy? I don't think so. There are a lot of applications of AI in the pharmacy. And I know that the molecular docking, and then of course the molecular dynamics, then QSAR and pharmacophores. I mean, the research in these, you know, subdomain of computer-aided drug design has been phenomenal. And with the recent, you know, time wherein the everything is going to be digitalized, most of the things are in the digital, you know, way of happening in this particular time, definitely the use of the current technology of AI will bring a tremendous change in the computer aided drug design. What didn't happen in last few years, when some of the speakers mentioned that how as a nation, the pharmacy industry failed in drug discovery, and even though the other sector they went ahead, and how this particular technology couldn't be taken along with the other subject. So the computer aided drug design, of course, is very important, and I'm sure with the current application of AI, this particular branch in this particular topic, especially in the pharmaceutical chemistry, is going to be really, really upcoming topic or subject. So another one is the pharmacy management system. So it is a kind of the very primary type of AI system is there, in that the pharmacy, the data is stored, and that helps the pricing and even the prescription match to the correct doses, and customer insurance claims and everything, they can be integrated in this pharmacy management system, or we say the pharmacy information system, which is already currently in use but need to upgrade. So it is already using some of the preliminary type of AI. Even drug interaction checkers are already there, wherein we can reduce the prescription errors before handing out the prescription. So I mean, the precision prescription can be done with the drug interaction checkers. Even pharmacy robots, actually is not fully or independent dispensers of the medicine, but they are in the mixed dispensary profile. That means in UK, the pharmacies are already using these robots, but they are not given the full authority by the national healthcare system to dispense the medicine. They are just the assistant to the pharmacist in UK, even in other countries. The reason behind that is that because they are very good in organizing the medicine in the self, even taking the medicine from the self, wherein the human cannot reach on the top shelves and all. So these pharmacy robots are quite helpful, assisting the pharmacist. But in the future, we will see how this is going to turn out with the current AI development, and how these robots will come along in the future. So next is a manufacturing process improvement and pharmaceutical product like pill with the sensors. I mentioned to you, it's not new. Even 2017, the FDA approved some of the pills with the sensor, wherein the physician or even the caretaker of the patient will know whether the patient has taken the pill or not when it reaches to the stomach, and then the sensor will give a clue to the mobile app. So even the health trackers and wearables, we know about the Fitbit, and so many other health trackers are there which are already in the market, and the pharmacy notification to the patient about refilling of the prescriptions. So this is again the integration of the pharmacy management system, wherein if the patient don't come back for refilling the prescription, the notification can be sent. Coming to the drug adherence, of course, the dose of should be taken by the patient on the given time, so that can be monitored. Even the personalized medicine for the rare disease is another area, and also identifying the clinical trial candidate according to the the profile of the person can also be identified. So as I mentioned to you, this FDA actually approved pill with the sensor that digitally track if the patient has ingested their medication. It was in 2017. The micro boats can be injected in the human, to fix many of the health issues in future. And drug dispensing, as I mentioned, is still a questionable, but the robots in pharmacy are only the assistant at present. some of the pharmacies, they are even using robot as a helper to clean the pharmacy. As I mentioned to you, the automatic disinfection can be one of the application of the robots. So I think I already told about the pharmacy management system, where in the information can be integrated and can be quite handy to the pharmacist. Even the drug interaction checkers and all can in future can also be integrated, where in the when the pharmacy the pharmacist is dispensing the medicine, can be alerted if any drug is having any kind of interaction. Even the nutraceuticals or any other supplements are having any kind of interactions. So drug interaction checkers are also based on the, you know, some of the AI applications, wherein they can check if there is any kind of interactions in the drugs. So the drug interactions can be drug-drug interaction, drug-food interaction, drug-herb interactions, or, you know, specific disease, and then drug allergy interaction, then drug gene interaction. So gene interaction means now we know about the gene therapy. Now this was like in future gene therapy will be, you know, one of the prominent medicine, and now we see now most of the vaccines are coming up. So I mean the future of medicine is definitely going to be, you know, be different. So coming to the drug discovery, some of the pharma companies, now they are using the AI for in the drug discovery, like Novartis and Verse Genomics. Even some of the new startup also there in this, then Merck company, then Cyclica, then Tenant Holding and AstraZeneca, IBM, Watson, and JNS Healthcare. DeepSeek again is a startup. Another use here is I think it's mainly in the computer aided drug design, where in the discovery of the new drug inspired by the nature, and we know that how these herbals or plant based drugs, how they are helpful. And if you look at the history, 50% of these today's drugs, what they have is actually inspired by the nature. So you I mean, many of the researchers now, they are actually utilizing the quite many number of the species of the plants, and then they are feeding up the data or these particular isolated these chemical structures, and then trying to find the alternatives which have the, you know, better effects and better ADME profile and cheaper in the manufacturing. Drug repurposing again is something new in the COVID. But earlier, we know about the aspirin. We know it's not officially repurposed, but we know in the practice, the physicians, how they use the medicine. So here also, if you see in the current scenario, this drug repurposing is again become very important. So what is a drug repurposing? A strategy for identifying the new indication for the approved or investigational drug that has not been originally approved or dedicated. So that is the drug repurposing. Now, why it is important is because finding out a new drug and identifying the safety of that drug in upcoming years, let's say 6 to 8 years or 10 years, is something which is quite time consuming, rather than finding a drug as an alternative which is already in the market, which is already in market from last 10, 15, 20 years. That means the safety profile is already, is experienced. So those drugs can be, of course, the dose is again the important parameter here. So dose has to be identified, because the dose and toxicity is having the direct relationship. So drug repurposing has been explored during this COVID-19. And there has been many drugs actually which was tried for the repurposing purpose. We know about the case of chloroquine and hydroxychloroquine, ivermectin, monoclonal antibodies, and then favipiravir, and then of course and so many other antiviral agents. But on October 22, 2020, the FDA approved remdesivir for the use in the adult and pediatric patient 12 years of age and older and weighing at least 40 kg for the treatment of COVID-19 situation requiring the hospitalization. So many other drugs are still under investigation, like this one of the leading pharmaceutical company in Japan, Kowa. Actually, they have taken ivermectin for the clinical trial in Japan. And this is a recent news of 2nd July, wherein they will carry out the Japanese clinical trial for this antiparasitic drug, ivermectin, for the treatment of COVID-19. So this repurposing also involved the artificial intelligence, we can say the role into it. So Japan also set to use this supercomputer Fugaku and for the COVID-19 research. So they have tested the speed of the computer, and then they found that it is in the full operation, and they have already utilizing this particular supercomputer for the research purpose. And now it is this current situation has opened the doors for many other drugs and even many other the approaches. Like recently the drug for Alzheimer, I think you in as a pharmacist, I think we already aware about the new drug approvals. So even the repurposing of the drug in the artificial intelligence, machine learning has also been tried for the repurposing of the drugs in cancer and many other chronic diseases like HIV. So now coming to the alternative system of medicine. So what is the alternative system of medicine and what is the traditional medicine? So traditional medicine is the medicine which has been used in a particular country traditionally with a long history. Okay, so it is the total sum of the knowledge, skill, practice based on the theory, belief, experiences, different cultures. And these are used, these traditional medicines are used as a prevention, diagnosis, improvement or treatment or physical and mental illness. I think India is quite rich in the traditional system of medicine knowledge. And we have this Ayush as a ministry that is fully dedicated for this traditional and complementary medicine. What is a complementary medicine? Which is a bit different than the traditional. Not all the medicine practice in India under this Ayush is traditional. Not all are traditional because Ayurveda is traditional to India, right? So the complementary or alternative medicine is actually set of healthcare practice that are not the part of a country of their own tradition, but they are also not fully integrated in the traditional system of medicine or their system of medicine, but they are used interchangeably with it, or they are used along with the traditional medicine. So like with Ayurveda in India, there are so many other the alternative medicines which are actually used. So these are the traditional, complementary and alternative medicine: Ayurveda, Yunani, Reiki, homeopathy, chiropractic medicine, acupuncture, traditional Chinese medicine, in short TCM, osteopathic medicine, healing touch, yoga, energy medicine, Siddha medicine, naturopathy. And I think the five these important traditional and complementary medicine are already under the Ayush, right? Ayurveda, yoga, Siddha, and Yunani and homeopathy. So if you see, the other traditional complementary medicines are orthomolecular medicine, aromatherapy, pack flavor remedies, Tibetan medical system, Native American system, traditional African medical medicine, behavioral medicine, hypnotherapy. So role of this AI in traditional and complementary medicine. So again, when all the sectors are growing with the current technology of AI, again this sector can also be cannot be left behind. So people in this area also utilizing lot of the applications of this AI based programs to improve. So some of the applications I have mentioned here, but there are many other applications which are coming up in this area as well. So what are the potential areas to explore in the traditional and complementary medicine? One is to see the efficacy of autonomous robot massage and traditional medicine massage skills. And it's already there in the practice in some of the countries like Singapore. So later I'll show some of the examples wherein the robot massage is actually used in traditional Chinese medicine. Pairing of AI technology with the pulse diagnosis. And we know that in Ayurveda, even in the traditional Chinese system of medicine, this pulse diagnosis is very critical, very, very important to differentiate, do the differential diagnosis. Okay, so there is also some of the work which is done to integrate this AI into the pulse diagnosis. Effect of sitting posture recording system on patient meditation. Meditation treatment. So even the meditation postures and all, that is also the area where in some of the work is done to integrate the AI. Then IoT sensors on patient yoga therapy. In fact, some of the applications are already in the market. Then wearable device in traditional medical diagnosis. So the devices which can predict the diagnosis and use of automatic equipment in formulation of drugs versus traditional methods. So like automatic dispensing system, automatic equipment in formulation, what we say the robotics in the industry, formulation industry, then computational detection, again the computer aided drug design in the detection of the phytochemicals, and then pharmacokinetic investigation and toxicity test in the traditional medicine. Although most of the traditional medicines are time tested with the less side effects, then screening of herbs, ingredients and components, and even their combination of these formulations, what we say the polyherbal formulation, using this big data or AI based technologies. So if you look at here the picture, that is of an app, and this app is actually a Zenia app, and this app sends a signal to the teacher, who is a yoga teacher, to see whether the student is doing that yoga practice correctly or not. So it is actually a kind of assistant to the instructor, and of course the instructor is the final instructor have the final say if there is any kind of corrections in the technique of the yoga which is used. And this app already featured by the Apple App Store. You can get this app, and this Zenia use the neural network and the classic computer vision algorithms with 95% of accuracy. That means still a lot of data needed to bring it to the 100% or even more than 95%. So still they are working to get more and more data so that they can in the future they can make it more precise. So Zenia says that application is not an instructor but is actually an assistant. So the yoga assistant, the yoga instructor will have a final say on the corrections. This is one of the very important paper on the validation study which was actually carried out in the traditional Chinese medicine assistive diagnostic system. So the group of researchers from the China Academy of Chinese Medical Science, Beijing, China, they have done actually the work, and the team of these researchers or scientists, they have done the work to integrate this AI system in the traditional or TCM, we say, to develop a diagnostic system. So I'll just give the gist of the paper, how they did and what was the outcome. So the objective of this research was to develop the artificial intelligence based assistive diagnostic system. They used the Chinese medicine health records. They had the electronic health records and of quite many years. So this is very, very important in clinics to have the electronic health records. So they utilized, they have the system wherein they accumulated those health records and they utilized to diagnose the multiple types of diseases by feeding these health records into the AI-based system. So they use this unstructured freestyle electronic health records and they use this natural language processing techniques to extract the clinical information such as signs and symptoms from these unstructured health records. And then they use the CNN to predict the disease type out of 187 disease in traditional Chinese system of medicine. So 187 types of diseases based on the clinical data, they were further processed and then give the prediction based on the sign and symptoms that in out of these 187 type of diseases, which could be the disease to a particular patient. So the result, they suggested that they have a good diagnostic accuracy, and the disease type prediction accuracy, they had even more than 90%, 91.6 and 94.2 in some of the models. And they mentioned that there is a still need of more data. So they need to they look forward to feed more data to make the system even better in the future. So here they have used, these are the systems they have used. So they have used the four subsystems, and it's a natural languages processing. And that natural language processing, we say the NLP in short, that actually takes a note from the unstructured in the electronic health record and produce the structured data. So first, whatever the unstructured, what you say this, they have this information from the patient that has to be structured, and that they use the NLP for that, and then feature extraction. So the feature extraction, that means some of the data was not relevant, some of the entries were not there, they were not proper, so the data was cleaned and standardized. So that feature extraction was done after doing the standardization of the data, and then clinical information was actually done by this feature extraction system, and then disease diagnosis, and then this vectorized data, which is standardized data, which was fed into the disease diagnostics network to predict the disease, and then syndrome prediction, then give to the syndrome prediction subsystem to produce the list of syndrome. So this is how they utilize these four subsystems to give the prediction of the disease and further give the list of the syndrome in particular disease. So they use even this natural language processing subsystem that was used for generating the structured data from the unstructured data. And then this is just what I mentioned, that the feature extraction system was used to to remove the redundant data or non-relevant data, to standardize the data. Okay, and then they use this CNN or convolutional neural network model to use for processing the text disease diagnostic subsystem, and this was actually selected based on the sample size, hardware equipment performance, and model complexity, characteristic of the health records, and the past experience of the researchers based on the previous research done in this area. And then they use these algorithms, and these they actually integrated these algorithms. So they use this integrated model, and this integrated model, they select the final output from the outputs of the four algorithms by the majority rule. Okay, so they use this is the block diagram of the algorithm they use, and then they use this backpropagation, random forest, and support vector classifiers, and extreme gradient boosting. So the as per the majority rule, the selection decision is based upon the highest number of the votes for the output from each of the four algorithms. So that is the majority rule, and this approach, it overcomes the drawbacks of the unfitting and overfitting, and also takes the advantage of the strength of the individual algorithms in predicting the syndrome for some but not for the other types of diseases. So the data set was obtained from the traditional Chinese medicine hospital in Beijing in China, and as you can see that this is the prediction result of this research paper, and they found this integrated mean accuracy of 0.913, which is better than any of the other model, the four individual models. So they found this integrated model to be more suitable. In the terms of limitation, they actually spent 2 years in single traditional Chinese medicine hospital, which is actually quite a small data in terms of the prediction. So additional clinical data is needed to further improve the system. So that's what the previous speakers also told in the previous discussions, that data is very, very important for the AI, and especially the authentic data, the clean data. So this is another method developed for the traditional medicine prescription generation based on the deep learning technology. So this actually was developed by the Zheng Zhou team at the Shenyang Institute of Automation of the Chinese Academy of Science, wherein they develop actually a kind of AI system which can prescribe the herbs based on the symptoms of the patient. So here, the prescription generation model for the intelligent TCM research. So the features of the patient symptoms are first extracted using the deep recurrent neural network, and then based on the severity of the different symptom of the patient, each herb in the prescription can be dynamically generated according to the corresponding system. So this is like a dynamic system based on the patient symptoms. So the prescription can be generated by using this model. Even the other areas for exploration are also under progress, like pulse pattern recognition, which is quite complex. Even in Ayurveda also, the pulse diagnosis is one of the I think the difficult area. It has been said like the real Ayurvedic physician is the one who actually understand the pulse diagnosis. So the classification of yoga pose using the machine learning. So this is the paper from India, wherein the researchers has worked on the Surya Namaskara and the postures integrating the AI into it, and then collected the important time and use for the estimation of pose algorithm for the accuracy results of the yoga poses. And again, this is again a very important diagnostic protocol by Jiva Ayurveda. It is Jiva Ayurveda. They developed Jiva Ayurveda. They developed this IUNIQ come from IU means for Ayurveda, unique. Okay, so IUNIQ is the result of a huge data analytics. I read they actually utilize more than 20,000 patients data they have utilized so far, and I think more and more data when they're going to feed the results are going to be more promising in the future. So using the big data analytics and machine learning, this 5,000 year old knowledge of Ayurveda, we know the traditional system of medicine, this Ayurveda is exemplary in terms of in prevention, especially in prevention and during COVID-19, many of us realized that the use of Ayurvedic drugs for immunomodulation. So the treatment records of lakhs of patients at Jiva has been consolidated to offer most of the advanced decision support system for the Ayurvedic doctors. So again, this system is actually the assistant to the Ayurvedic doctor. The final say is from the doctors, not from this virtual assistant or AI-based system. So this will assist them in making the root cause-based diagnosis in structured, standardized, and data-driven manner, and allowing for the personalized treatment of the patient. So Jiva Ayurveda is already using AI and benefiting many patients by using the diagnostic developed by the Jiva Ayurveda based on AI. Even the Jiva Ayurveda, they are also using the telemedicine for the people in India and also abroad, and utilizing the AI at the great potential. So this is another news wherein the very famous Shehnaz Hussain, AI in the beauty. So this particular article says that the personalized card online can be filled by the individuals, and all the required details can be filled in the card. And after that, the custom-made products, after taking all the details into the account, the AI made by the AI, these products can be personalized. Individual beauty needs, the personalized as opposed to the standard solution for a particular skin type. So we know that skin type and the beauty products, they have a direct relation. So the personalized skin products can be done with the help of AI in the Ayurvedic industry. Recently, I think the WHO and Ayush, they have come out with the one of the understanding of, or you can say the joint understanding on the this Ayurveda nutraceuticals. So Ayurveda nutraceuticals is again upcoming booming market, wherein the drugs from the Ayurveda, they will be sold as a nutraceutical in India and abroad. So this is again another paper from the Ayurveda, wherein this is actually done from the scientists from the CSIR and from the, I mean, the IR genomics unit of the Sutra, they call. And here they have actually utilized the AI to diagnose the type of prakriti. Okay, so here they have used the this is just a visual presentation of the prakriti interpretation process based on the original textual references here. So here the outermost circle, as you can see, V is for vata, P is for pitta, kapha is for kapha. So for example, if the skin type is thin, we know the skin, if it is thin, it is can be a vata or it can be pitta, definitely not kapha, it will be thick. But if it is thin, it can be vata or pitta. But if it is dry and rough, it will be interpreted as vata type. And if it is oily and loose, it will be like a pitta type. Likewise, like if the health problem in cold could be due to the vata and kapha, and humidity can segregate further. If the problem in the moist with the cold, it is kapha. If the problem in cold and dry, then it will be vata. So these kind of differentiation can be done by a trained Ayurvedic physician. So such kind of the predictions were made by using the AI, by using the group of the scientists. So based on the physician judgment and the responses of the subject, the individual were classified into 7 subtypes. So 7 subtypes are like vata, pitta and kapha. These are actually the extreme the prakritis, because it's very hard or very rare to find vata, pitta and kapha like in only one prakriti person. Normally the prakriti nowadays can be a dvidoshaj or tridoshaj. That means dvidoshaj means vata pit, a person can be vata kapha, the person can be pitta kapha, or person can be vata pitta kapha. Okay, so the classification is done for the 7 subtypes. And both the unsupervised and supervised machine learning approaches were used for the phenotype data. It was done in North India, actually, this particular study. And then random forest model were actually constructed and used with the R statistical programming language. And then supervised modeling of the questionnaire was done with the Lasso model, Elastic Net model, and random forest model. Mostly these algorithms were used. And then out of this 147 extreme prakriti samples, 80 were the female, then 23 were kapha, 14 were pitta, 44 were vata, and 66 samples were 23 kapha, 21 vata, and 22 were vata males. Sorry, 23 kapha, 21 pitta, and 22 vata males. So validation of this data was also done. And then the segregation of extreme and non-extreme prakritis are also done based on the probabilities. So here, this is the model actually for strategy, what they use. So in the A, you can see it is an extreme prakriti type. So they use 147 extreme prakriti type. They use around 106, which is the non-extreme. That means mixed type, vat pit or pit kaf. And the maximum probability scores were utilized to create the binomial logistic regression for classification of extreme and non-extreme. So based on these 3 models, Lasso, ElasticNet, and Random Forest, and based on the high probability score, the further the extreme and non-extreme prakritis was actually predicted by using this model. So if you look at the result, the best model selected, which actually have the high sensitivity and high specificity, which is more than 90%. So here you can see the elastic net is having more than 90%. Even random forest is also having more than 90%. So I think the study was quite promising. So another area is the IR genomics, wherein the AI can be introduced improve the area of IR genomics. And what is IR genomics? It is actually the integration of the principle of Ayurveda with the genomics. And it is more on the personalized approach in Ayurveda. As we know, the Ayurveda is actually a personalized medicine. And next is the, as I mentioned to you, that robotics in the traditional system of medicine. So one of the, you know, Nova Health traditional Chinese medicine clinic they use in Singapore, named the robot named Emma Massage. So here, the Singapore first robot massage in the NTU, Nanyang Technological University. So this robot was used in the traditional Chinese medicine clinic along with the human colleague, that means again supervised as a massage therapist. The meditation practice, again, some of the research papers are published, and some of the even companies, they are working on it so that they can integrate this artificial intelligence into the meditation practice, especially the the poses and also the techniques which is used into the meditation. This is again one more important the development which happened into the automatic dispensing system for traditional Chinese medicine. So the researchers, they actually develop the robotic arm based advanced automatic dispensing system with the machine vision to assist in the collection of the ingredient for the herbal decoctions. So this experiment, they use the 5 packets of the prescription containing 6 types of the herbs, and they use the automated process and the trivial all algorithms, and this is the human machine interface for the automatic dispensing system. This AI based drug interactions and supplement interactions. So we know drug interaction, but there is a possibility of the even this nutraceuticals and herbal supplement interactions. So there are the search engines wherein you can find a lot of interactions. Then also you will find so many mobile apps for this is the advancement in the taxonomy, and we know this traditional medicines, they use this plant-based medicine. So the taxonomical identification can also be done by using the mobile apps. So there are few mobile apps like PlantNet, iNaturalist, PlantSnap. They can give the, when you scan the leaf or the very close-up of the plant part, it can give you the possible, the names of the plant species and even the very close. Of course, you need to further confirm with the help of taxonomists. So these mobile apps are already there in the practice, and people are utilizing. So now coming to the challenges, there are a lot of challenges of the AI. As we know that when you put this digital, data at a one place, there is definitely a risk of cyber attacks, stealing of data. And this is actually published on 6 July, few days before only. And that kind of, this hacking actually happened into this Tesla model. So the Tesla autonomous vehicle was hacked by a McAfee technician, and the technician was able to trick the Tesla vehicle into misreading the 35 miles per hour sign by adding a few inches of the black tapes, and then the vehicle interpreted it as 85 miles per hour sign. As a result, the car accelerated, and that mishap happened. So now the family actually suing the company. So these kind of challenges are there, and definitely the privacy protection of data, these are the upcoming challenges in this particular area. So now the WHO has come out with the principles or guidelines for the ethics in the health AI. So these regulating agencies, they already know, and they are actually keeping an eye or keeping a vigil to lay down some of the principles or ethics, so that the companies or the industries which are involved in this AI sector could be regulated. So some of these ethical principles by WHO, they are listed here. One is protect the autonomy. So as per the WHO, the AI, they should not be made entirely, the decision should not be made entirely by machines. and the doctor should be able to override them at any point of time. So these principles are laid down in the healthcare of AI, you know, health sector of and artificial intelligence. Promote human safety. So these robots or other applications of the AI, they should not cause any injury and they should not cause any harm. Then transparency again is a very important too hard for the researchers and doctors to know how this AI make the decisions. So WHO want to see if there is a transparency and fully audited, and the functions are understood by the users and the regulators. So since it is a very complex system, so it has to be simplified so that it could be communicated to the common man who is using that particular application or device, or going to be affected by the particular procedure. They should understand the integrity of that particular application. The foster accountability. Now, as I mentioned, the case of a car accident happened because of the hacking, right? Now, who is going to be held responsible? Because the car was driverless. I mean, it was automatic, AI based. So there should be a mechanism to determining who is responsible, whether the manufacturer or clinical users. So if damage or any kind of the health error, or you can say the prescription error, or it can be any damage to the patient happened, who is going to be responsible? So that kind of decision should also be that accountability should also be set up. Then ensure the equity. That means it should be available in multiple languages, and there should not be any racial bias in the programs. Now, sustainable. That means update. Even the mobile apps also. You see so many mobile apps, and there is always an update. So in the future also, you will see most of the mobile apps will be inbuilt, because update take a lot of data, a lot of space. So the updates should be regularly done on their tools, and institutions or companies should only introduce tools that can be repaired or even under source health system. So the repairing and their update should also be taken care, and the system should be sustainable, which can be used for the long time. So that's all from me. I really appreciate the audience for your patientful listening and attention, and I would like to thank the organizer for giving me the opportunity for sharing my thoughts in such a wonderful topic. Thank you very much. I'll be happy to answer if any question.
We have received some questions on chat box, sir.
Okay. Okay, elaborate on the drug adherence is work. I think one question is, I want to know or elaborate on the drug adherence work. Okay, I just mentioned one of the technology which was utilized in the medicine approved by the FDA, wherein they included the sensors in the pill. So like, as I mentioned, certain patients, they forget to take the pill. So the sensor can give the clue. So these technologies can be definitely can be utilized in the future. So if you want to know more, maybe you can send an email to me. I can further discuss on this particular area. How AI develops in helps in the drug repurposing? I think the data, the big data which is available, and these the supercomputers, or even these AI algorithms, they can be utilized to predict the suitable candidates based on the the target molecule. Whether any drug has been developed by using any pharma majors at the present for the treatment of COVID-19? I don't think only the vaccines are actually currently the WHO and even the FDA, they're all pushing this vaccine as a main treatment. Only the remdesivir, I think it was approved by the FDA, and even there's still not fully agreement with the other agencies, with the WHO and FDA on the, you know, the repurposing of the remdesivir. So I think the AI-based traditional drugs, traditional medicine, I don't think there is any drug based on AI which is available for the treatment in COVID-19. To my knowledge, maybe if anything come up, definitely you can always drop an email to me. I will update you in that regard. Okay, I don't see any other question. If any other question, I will be happy to reply.
You can check on screen, sir.
Sorry?
It is on screen, sir. You can check.
Yeah, that drug, whether any drug has been developed by using AI by any pharma major that present the treatment. That's what I told. To my knowledge, I don't think so. Only the vaccines, but not the drug for the treatment. Because we know the vaccines are prevention, right? Vaccines are for prevention, not for the treatment. Is there any AI-based traditional drug available in the treatment of COVID-19? I don't think so. But however, I read the news of this Patanjali, wherein they use this computer-aided drug design to predict the use of ashwagandha. That is Vidania somnifera as an immunomodulator, okay, as an immunomodulator to mitigate the signs and symptoms in the COVID-19. So that paper I see they publish in one of the reputed journals. So that I'm aware of, by of course using the computer aided drug design. So the AI is involved in that. So yeah. Any other question?
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. You have given clear information regarding artificial intelligence in our traditional and complementary medicines. So it will be very useful for the participants, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Dr. Ramkesh Singh, sir, for such a nice presentation. The entire session was too lively, engaging and educative because of your presence, sir. May I request our federal principal and convener of this EFDP, Professor B.V.P. Ravi Kumar, sir, to felicitate Dr. Mukesh Singh Sikawa, sir, with an E-Certificate of Appreciation as a badge of our deepest sense of gratitude and respect from entire Roland fraternity.
Thank you, Dr. Mukesh, for accepting our invitation and sharing valuable knowledge. And this part of information was untouched by any other resource person in this FDP. It is really very useful. And on behalf of Roland Institute of Pharmaceutical Sciences, I would like to present you this E-Certificate of Appreciation. Kindly accept it, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Ravi Kumar. I would like to
thank you so much,
your entire team. I would like to congratulate and thank your entire team for taking in efforts for organizing such a wonderful the faculty development program. And I look forward to see more and more coming up in this area, because this area definitely need to be explored in pharmaceutical science, because we don't want to be behind than the other sectors. So I would like to even appreciate all the participants who are also the, some of them, they are even professor, assistant professor, because they are also faculty members. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. I leave the studio, sir. Thank you.
Yes. Dear participants, with this, the second session of Day 5 EFDP program has come to an end. We'll be resuming again at 2 p.m. today with a yoga practice session on the YouTube mode. And a valedictory ceremony is also scheduled to happen through Zoom link. The link has been already distributed in the WhatsApp group and through your registered email also. Please make some time to attend both the yoga session and the valedictory function of today's event. So thank you all for your kind participation and for your cooperation. Thank you very much.